welcome again to the scriptorium. And this lesson, number 15, is a continuation of the previous one, that is plate number 17 on rhythm. In this program, I want to show you how I work in classes with music. Now, years ago, after a class where I'd worked with the Mozart, an instructor told me, "I hear today that you were teaching calligraphy with background music." Well, I stopped him right off. I was not using background music. I dislike the whole idea of background music very much. I don't think that one should have background music. I dislike it in bars. I dislike it in restaurants. If I'm with friends, I want to be able to talk with them. And I don't want to have music back there making so much noise I can't hear what they are saying. And if there's music, if it's worth anything at all, I want to listen to it. If it's not worth anything, I don't care about listening to it. I think we should do one thing at a time. And we should either listen to music or have conversation with friends. But background music, I think, is a big mistake. I suppose it has its uses in big chain stores where people are made to feel happy and relaxed and possibly will fall for a lot of impulse buying and so on. But I don't think that has much to do with music considered as an art form. In airports, it's rather agreeable, I find, because I've done quite a bit of flying, to have an hour or two to wait to have some sound going on that one can listen to while waiting for the flight. Now, some people are very timid about flying, and I suppose it does help calm their nerves a little bit. They may try in the bar to find something that will calm their nerves, and between that and the music, maybe they are a little more able to climb onto a plane without feeling like fainting or turning around and rushing off home. But background music's something else. I would never, never want to use background music as such in the class. Now, I use it for the purpose of introducing a student to rhythmical movement. And in talking with other teachers about this, some of the teachers in the Midwest and the Far East, they disagree with me sharply. They say, you cannot write to music. Well, they say the music is too subtle, it's too varied. And that it would be impossible to write to it. There may be something there, but I wish you'd try to understand what I mean by writing, using music, and I wish you'd try it. Maybe I'm wrong, I don't think so, because I've been able to get rather fascinating results from it. Been able to free students from a certain amount of stiffness by their using it. But don't get the idea that I recommend that you play some excellent piece of music while you're doing an important commission in calligraphy or in handwriting. Work with silence, complete silence if possible. The music certainly should seem to be in the rhythmical movement of the pen, but it's an interior music. It's not a music that comes from outside. The music should come from the rhythm of the writing, and you may hear it inside, hear some sort of melody, hear some sort of symphonic work being played, but it should come from the writing. It should not be physically audible music while you're doing serious work, while you're writing a commission. Your thought should be on the rhythm of the pen movement and on the meaning of what you're writing out, especially, I'd say, on the significance of the words which you are using. I don't see much point in writing just to write, just to have rhythmical writing, but the whole thing is subordinated to saying something that is important to us. We feel that others should realize the importance of these statements. We write them out for them, maybe to put up on their wall, to have in their library where they can look at these statements occasionally. And the best kind of statements are ones that are not obvious, not ones that are trite and familiar, so that you look at them once and never again, except maybe to look at the ornament or the examples of calligraphy. but they should be statements that will grab the imagination, which will tease one and make one want to wrestle with the meaning, the way Jacob wrestled with the angel. Now remember that the word angel in Greek means messenger, and in the Bible, in Hebrew and in Greek both, the messenger is a messenger from God. The angel has something to say, and I don't know whether any theologian or biblical scholar would agree with me, but I like the idea of Jacob wrestling all night with a meaning that came to him, and it wasn't until morning that he was able fully to have that meaning, to succeed in his wrestling with it. I would like to think of the pen being moved by the music. Now, what do I mean by that? I suggest that sometime when you're at the beach, if you can, you have a bottle of ink and the Japanese or Chinese type pointed brush, and load it with ink and watch seagulls for a while. And then, without necessarily looking at the paper at all, try to move the brush with the movement of the seagull. Let the seagull direct the movement of that brush on the paper. I think you may be astonished at how beautifully you're doing. When we start with this, when you start working with music, I would suggest that you listen to the music for some time without thinking of writing even. Listen to it, let it fill your body from head to foot. Let the music so fill you that your body wants to move with the music until finally you feel that the musical rhythm can flow out of your body into your shoulder, down through your arm, into your wrist, and into your hand, and then your hand starts moving with it. That is, give your pen to the composer or to the conductor, to the musicians. I'd like to think of one giving his hand or giving his pen to Mozart and letting Mozart do the writing. If you experiment with your eyes shut, you'll find that you can write quite beautifully. Maybe not exactly the way you'd want. Letters won't always connect properly. But you'll find that you can write beautifully, rhythmically, without the mind entering in and boggling the whole works up by giving the hand advice, by practicing with your eyes shut. Now, when you're filled with the music, I would not watch the paper very much. Remember, this is just an experiment in rhythm. So listen entirely, concentrate completely on the music. Let the music flow through you and flow onto the paper. And if you're watching anything visually, watch the edge. So, with Mozart's Symphony No. 40 in G minor, which you hear at the beginning and at the ending of each program, you might get your pen out and try moving your pen to the rhythm of that work. Move your pen as if you were conducting the symphony, or better, I'd say, let the symphony conduct you, so that Mozart's doing the writing and you aren't doing it at all. Well, let's see if we can learn something about rhythmical movement by listening to Mozart's Symphony No. 40 in G minor.